next up we have Tony Gosling, who's an investigative journalist, presenter on Bristol Radio. This is his critique of mainstream media, the mainstream media since 9/11.
So. We're in a weird world, aren't we, where cyber war and economic war is happening, not like World War II quite so much with tanks. Finian Cunningham talks about them as panzer banks. So there's all sorts of types of terrorism around there. So let's have a listen now to Richard Cottrell. And this is how mainstream this is. Richard's a mainstream, was a mainstream journalist. He was an MEP, Tory MEP in Westminster. So this is what he has to say about him.
Roughly about the time that 7/7 occurred, I'm a former journalist. And what depressed me about the reactions to 7/7 and shortly afterwards the death of the Brazilian Tiradentes was the willingness of public opinion to believe the official explanation of events. That's one thing. The second was the behavior of the mainstream media, who simply swallowed the dose given out by the government like a bunch of Strasbourg geese. There was no attempt whatsoever to question of what obviously considerable difficulties in the account, which was emanating from the authorities. So really, my concern here was not only that I didn't believe the official account, but I also recognized that journalism has an honorable, free-thinking, truth-seeking profession in the UK with debt.
So he finishes there, pretty much, my opinion, which is another, I thought I'd just look at some of the reasons why journalism is pretty much, as we might say, dead there. We did a debate earlier on this year with a guy called Tim Tate and Phil Chamberlain. Phil's a university lecturer in journalism at the University of Western England. And it was a debate about whether, because there's this kind of myth out there, that the internet can take over from the big investigative programmes like World in Action, First Tuesday, the old-fashioned Panorama, Roger Cook and his Cook Report, which many of you I'm sure will remember, Tim Tate won hands down over Phil because Phil was arguing that bloggers can do it. What Tim explained was that some of these investigations took 3 years and cost up to £1 million to do the investigation. Mm. And there's just no way bloggers can compete with that or get anywhere near close to it. There's also, I mean, the separation really between the individual journalists and the outlets. I mean, John Pilger, everybody knows, not so many people have heard of people like Pippa King, who's been writing about RFID chips and identification, radio identification chips, that kind of thing. And Julie Beale, I've interviewed, who's done a brilliant article for Activist Post about the global smart ID, which is being rolled out as part of universal credit when that comes in. It's an ID program that basically, unless you get this digital ID, you won't get any money, and you have to use it across the internet. The other thing with that is, you know, with this digital ID thing, if something goes wrong with it, you've got no money. Suddenly you're switched off. And this is becoming almost money, and digital money is becoming like almost a digital cage. So censorship's been going on since ancient Egypt. I mean, we can say we started in 9/11, but for example, if you go through the hieroglyphs, you'll find battles that the Egyptians lost are not there in the hieroglyphs, only the battles they won. Also, you get going a little bit more up to date, I suppose, the Wapping dispute. It's always easy to remember when Wapping happened, which is 1984, funnily enough, as the George Orwell year. That's the one thing it's easy to remember, hopefully, anyway, for people. That was a result of something which had been going on at the Times. People may not remember this, but the chairman of the Times newspapers, actually, I think it was the chief executive, was Marmaduke Hussey, up until 1980, when there was a massive dispute. And Hussey effectively caused this dispute by being really belligerent with the unions and shut the newspaper down for several weeks. That's when Murdoch snapped up the Times. And Murdoch has been an absolute vampire. In the British media for a long time. The ex-chairman of HTV I used to know, I mentioned Rupert Murdoch's name in his car once, and he said, don't mention that name in his car. That is poison! And of course, slowly but surely, Murdoch is poisoning the entire British media with his vile stuff. And actually, I did have earlier on my little badge on saying, save the BBC, because the BBC is the only thing standing between Murdoch and total takeover. Mm. However much you might dislike the BBC, they do a lot of good stuff as well as the rubbish. So The Wapping dispute, really important. It was Murdoch really just beating the unions to pieces at the newspapers. In the old days, the printers' union and the journalists' union, the journalists would write an article, and that article would be handed to the printers, the editors wouldn't get involved, right? There was no editor going in and saying, we're changing this, we're changing that. Now, that happens very, very easily, and happened on the 77th, by the way. Then, in 1987, Alistair Milne at the BBC, Marmaduke Hussey appears again to sack Alistair Milne. He was the Director General that had been bravely putting on programmes like Maggie's Militant Tendency on Panorama, which were very critical of the Conservative Party, in the same way as most of the rest of the media have been critical of Labour Militant. And that was really the end of the beginning of the end of the BBC, because once Milne was out, you had John Burt and Burtism, which was basically the slow commercialisation of the BBC, which is when I was working there. Then we have documentaries like 1992 BBC's Gladio film about Operation Gladio. Amazing thing that they were producing this kind of stuff. But this was really the last gasp. Also, Conspiracy of Silence, which was made by Yorkshire Television for Discovery Channel in 93. Slowly but surely, the investigative programmes were being shut down. In 2000, I think, was the last edition of Roger Cook's Cook Report. That was the News of the World. A load of sneers about that, that destroyed Roger Cook's programme. They took it off the air, and it never was allowed back on again, even though it had been the biggest, by far, grossing current affairs programme with the biggest audience in the country. Even if people had just tuned in to see if Roger was going to get beaten up that week, doing his investigative journalistic stings. It was pulling in a massive audience for News and Current Affairs, no one had ever seen before. And he was doing a fantastic job. So there's no economic argument for this shutdown of investigative journalism. Then I suppose we could go look at the shutdown after the Iraq War in Baghdad. In 2004, there was an article in the Al-Sadr newspaper in Iraq, in Baghdad, saying that a suicide bombing wasn't a suicide bombing at all. It was simply a helicopter that fired a missile, a bus cue. And after they published this story in the Al-Sadr newspaper on the front page, which was a weekly Iraqi paper, Bremer turned up with his Humvees and shut the newspaper down, padlocked it, and took all the stuff so they couldn't publish anymore. That was the beginning of the Shia insurgency in Iraq. So it's a very important, thanks, very important in keeping us safe is having a free press. Very important. Because if people can't express their opinions and can't tell the truth, then they start getting angry. Then we had what I was talking about earlier on in 77 with Mark Honigsbaum, is this new digital world in The Guardian. I spoke to Mark Honigsbaum a few months after 77. He was a reporter who was at Edgware Road tube station and reported on his audio report, morning 77, that the bombs were underneath the trains. He actually says that from immediately having spoken to scores of people who'd just come out of the tube station, the bombs were underneath the train. So I phoned him up a few months afterwards. I said, why, your article that appeared in the newspaper the day after 7/7, Mark, you said the bombs were inside the trains, it was suicide bombers. Well, how did it change? And there was a long pause. Mark said on the phone, he said, well, not everything I submit as property ends up in the next day's newspaper. And that was what Wapping was really all about. Is now you've got editors and managers can digitally change what journalists are saying when it appears in the newspaper. Then Michael Hastings, 2013, the death of Michael Hastings in the United States. He was investigating Paul Brennan, the head of the CIA, and Mercedes, and the CIA, it seems. No one can be 100% sure, but it's certainly the evidence points towards his car being hacked and hijacked, and his car then being driven into a tree at 85 miles an hour. Michael Hastings was no more. His girlfriend said the car was acting suspicious up earlier in the evening, and he wasn't sure, he didn't want to use his car. Mercedes have got some real big questions to answer about what happened to Michael Hastings. We hear nowadays, don't we, about things going viral on Facebook. Now this is also, how do they go viral? Can the NSA press a button to make Facebook go viral or something now? Because this is the real danger. We've got the National Security Agency funding Google, Twitter, Facebook behind the scenes. A lot of these tech giants' money is coming from the security services. So in a way, those, and you can't say 100%, but to a large extent, a lot of these tech companies are actually just kind of front-end shop windows for the security cracks, unaccountable security cracks. The media is the great prize, isn't it? Because it's the nerve system of humanity. Whoever can control that controls what we see and hear and think. And so there's a battle over it, and a lot of journalists like myself are trying to make sure the truth still can get out. I'll just sort of wind up now, I think, by talking about some really bang up-to-date stuff. One is this Volkswagen scandal. Seems to be very obvious. The 70 billion that's been euros has been wiped off Volkswagen is Americans punishing the Germans for not supporting them over Syria. Quite a few people have been commenting about this online, but it all happened at the same time. Rather naughty, Merkel decided she was going to not say that Assad had to go, that Assad could stay. And the Americans didn't like that. Also, this week's Panorama, I don't know, can you put your hand up? You saw Panorama on Tuesday night about the VIP file scandal. A few people. What we had there was a press release issued by the Metropolitan Police 15 minutes into the broadcast of that documentary, which was condemning it for intimidating witnesses. So what they were doing in that documentary, that Panorama, was discrediting, basically taking two or three people, including XRO News, and discrediting them. Now, what they didn't mention was the vast amount of, for example, former special branch officers that have been to the Independent Police Complaints Commission to say their investigations were shut down by MI5. It's interesting that the Met should release the press release to the BBC and to the world about a Panorama. It's effectively like a turf war. You've got a Panorama made by MI5, and you've got special branch saying, the Met saying, nobody don't like this, so they're releasing a press release against it. Final thing, carry a notebook. It's one of the things, once or twice I've been at places and I've just thought, had ideas, put two and two together. Always a good idea to carry a notebook with you, because that's what actually makes us humans different. I think once upon a time we were probably more like animals crawling around, But the thing that we can do is we can help sort this world out by being together with our thinking and our intellect and writing things down and transmitting that to others to share our knowledge. So that's what I'd like to see more of, more truth in terrorism. Thanks.